remotely. They can be across the world, and they can operate the rover. And we've built in little lessons where they can go up and try and identify the difference between a meteorite and a rock, take pictures of it, that sort of thing. There are scientific uses for the test bed as well. And at Stony Brook University, there is a vibrational spectroscopy lab. And this is, again, something where people would bring their samples to it and try and understand, or something that they built or created, try to understand more about how it would interact with and be interacted on some sort of process. So what it's made out of. Okay, another part I wanted to stress is the serving team collaborations that we have across the two lines. So just a couple of examples. This first one came about in the very first experience where we brought the principal investigators together to meet for the first time. And over this two-day period where they met face-to-face, we were at NASA Inc., we asked them to please come up with a list of areas where they thought their area could cross over and they could find a collaboration with one of the other teams. We had each of the teams do a little synopsis of what their proposal was. Now keep in mind, these were teams that were competitors just moments ago, and now we're asking them to share everything. Share your data, share your processes, tell us what you're going to do, and look for ways, trust each other, look for ways to work together. And they did it instantly. And one of the ideas that came out of it was to have this sample repository at the National Natural History Museum, where any team that collects any kind of field sample or had a sample that they made could bring it together and put it in one place, so that if you wanted to do some sort of process on it, you could know that you were using the same rock. Two different teams doing two different processes on the same sample is a lot better than using two entirely different samples that you just happen to think are the same rock or the same material. And this one ran into just a little bit of a hiccup, because it turns out the Natural History Museum does not take samples that are found on Earth, but they only take samples that you create. So we're looking for another home for the actual field samples at this point. But this was a great idea, and they started putting all their materials together right away. I was just really pleased to do that, to see that happen. And another one is the asteroid modeling. So the dynamics that we talked about with the early solar system and what happened to it when you had all this bombardment in the early days, when you couple that to geochemical studies of the rocks that people have found either from meteorite samples that have come off planet, you know, from someplace else, or the lunar samples that came back from the moon. You couple that together with the dynamics, and you can learn an awful lot about what happens when. And what we call the late heavy bombardment period that affected both the Earth and the moon system, is one of those times that we'd really like to understand better, because it looks very, very likely that the moon formed out of a Mars-sized body hitting the Earth. And when it hit the Earth, it knocked off a great deal of material, and out of that formed the moon. But what didn't make sense for a long time were the isotopic studies that we had and the chemical composition between the moon and the Earth. Those are now coming into much clearer focus in terms of how hot the Earth was, how wet the Earth was, how big that body was, what kind of angle that body had to hit the Earth at in order to make what we end up seeing on Earth. So it's just amazing. chemists and geologists getting together are making these kind of strides forward. I mean, those people would not even have gone to the same conferences, so they wouldn't have met, they wouldn't have talked, they wouldn't have shared down to this level the kind of research they're doing, and now they are, and out of that grows new science, new discoveries. So let's see, I've already said this about facility sharing and sample analysis, so I'll skip that. We also ask that the international partners collaborate with the domestic team. And so that Crater of the Moons campaign that I mentioned that Jennifer Heldman was running, that also, and Timothy Glotch, his team was part of that as well. That also had our Canadian partner as part of it. The dust accelerator that I mentioned, that was built with our partnership with Germany. So we can see an awful lot of the international flavor coming through as we move forward with first the Lunar Science Institute and the survey. So now I'd like to mention the Resource Prospector mission for just a second. CERMI has several people in and among our teams that are actively engaged in this. And Terry Fong, who's here in the room today from NASA Ames, is the deputy manager of the rover part of this NASA mission. This is a mission in development with the idea of developing technology that's generally applicable across many different target bodies, but ostensibly it would go to the moon. And the proposed mission demonstrates in situ resource utilization, in which you would collect and use the materials that you find on the body. And various critical mission aspects are being developed at NASA Ames. It has a lunar rover carrying the regolith and environment science and oxygen. Air testing has been conducted on Mauna Kea in Hawaii, one of my favorite places, in conjunction with the Pisces group there. Anyway, CERMI is facilitating the site selection and analysis activities for this mission. A number of our investigators are involved. Very excited, we hope that this mission goes forward. Okay, there are a lot of words on this page. The main point is I wanted to tell you that our central office does a whole lot more than just send out the money. Our institutes, each one of the teams are funded for 5 years, which give them long-term stability, and that's great for them. But what we also try to do is make sure that we at the central office take care of the big problems. Anything that would slow them down and take them away from their research, we would like to handle the central office. And then beyond that, the actual running of the institute, we do an awful lot of community engagement. Our job was to bring together the scientific and the exploration community. And again, those are groups that don't often mingle, but to show them that they had a lot in common and they had things that they needed to learn from each other. And so to do that, we have a lot of various activities here.
All right, so we have a number of things that we're doing to keep ourselves busy. We have the Exploration Science Forum. You're going to be hearing more about that, but that is our annual conference that we have at NASA Ames, where we have people from around the world gathering and talking about lunar planetary science. We also help coordinate a European conference, the European Lunar Symposium, with our partners in Europe. We've been working successfully. We've been involved with the LCROSS and LIDEE missions involving amateur astronomers and citizen science in actually making observations that contribute to the science of the mission. For instance, on the LIDEE mission, we had a number of amateur astronomers observing the moon during the course of the LIDEE mission. As LIDEE is flying around studying the atmosphere of the moon, we were looking at meteoroid impacts on the surface of the moon, seeing how those meteoroid impacts would correlate to changes in the structure and composition of the lunar atmosphere. We're working on opportunities for amateur astronomers to actually be measuring the orbits, measuring the positions and changes in the orbits of these near asteroids. That's very important because they don't feel constrained to be limited just by Kepler's laws of motion. That makes it clear. We're working with the SETI Institute just down the road here in a program where people have very simple security cameras pointed up in the sky. They're allowing them to record meteors as they come in. If you get enough people from slightly different sites recording that meteor, not only do you see its three-dimensional path coming down from the atmosphere, you can calculate what its orbit was before it encountered you. And that way we're discovering new meteor streams from comets as yet undiscovered, but whose orbits intersect those of Earth. And we're working with the NASA Tournament Lab and Topcoder program to develop improved algorithms for integration of data from spacecraft. Recently we've been working with LRO